文发表演说，但是等一下在提问的部分，大家可以用中文或英文提问都可以。那这场的讲者呢 ，Jonathan， 他是一位资深的 PHP 开发者，他同时呢也是 Zen Framework 1跟2的 contributor。那我们在加速我们网站效能的方法呢，其实有很多种，有的很简单，有的很复杂，有的需要花很多时间，但是呢却可能只得到一点点的改善。那今天 Jonathan 呢将为我们介绍五个简单的步骤，来能够很容易的提升我们网站效能的一些方法。Okay. Jonathan is a senior PHP developer and also the contributor of Zen Framework. There are lots of ways to increase the speed of web application, and today Jonathan will bring us five easy ways to increase performance with minimal changes to existing code. Let's welcome Jonathan. Thank you.
Thank you. Today, I'd like to talk about something which I believe every web developer in this room should be interested in. I'd like to talk about performance. And in particular, I'd like to offer you five easy ways by which you can increase the performance of your web applications with minimal changes to existing code. My name is Jonathan Maron. And I work for an international company. I'm based in Germany, but I spend often a lot of my time in Taipei and in the US. I'm the head of web development at this company. We manufacture digital cameras for industrial applications, scientific applications, and medical applications, in addition to server-side and desktop software. This session is split into five parts. First of all, we're going to have a look at why performance is important. Why should I care about performance? What's in it for me? And then we're going to have a look at optimizing images, and then optimizing HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. What a content delivery network is and why we should use one, and why we should be interested in a content delivery network. And then we're going to look at two rather technical points. The point of serving assets from multiple domain names called sharding, and then we're going to look at getting the HTTP headers of our resources correct. And after that, I'm going to make three suggestions for private study. So, why should I bother with performance? Why? Quite simply, a slow website decreases customer satisfaction. Decreased customer satisfaction lowers customer spending. For example, Amazon.com found out by increasing the load time by 100 milliseconds of their website, they lost 1% in sales. Or expressed in a US dollar amount, that's $2.4 billion per year simply for adding 100 milliseconds to their page load time. In addition, every one of you in here also should be interested in SEO, getting your website to the top of google.com and google.co.uk and the Taiwan version. Google announced in 2010 that faster websites increase user satisfaction and therefore improve the overall quality of the web. Want to get to number one in Google? Make sure your website's fast. When talking about performance, there are lots and lots of metrics. Google is interested in only one, the time to first byte. And throughout this presentation in these slides, I have linked to resources explaining more about the points on the slides. And at the end of the slides, you will see where you can download these slides and then click on the links and learn more. There are many more metrics when it comes to performance. But from Google's perspective, these are less important. And again, please click on this link, less important, and you'll see the source of this statement. When we talk about website performance, we have two major parts. We have the back-end performance and the front-end performance. This here is what's called a waterfall chart or waterfall diagram, and it shows the loading of Facebook.com. Facebook.com loads the HTML in in 164 milliseconds. And once the HTML is loaded, all the other resources which are linked into the HTML have to be downloaded. And as you can see, the time spent waiting for all this stuff to download is considerably longer than the time it takes to get the HTML from the backend server. So 80 to 90% of the end user response time is spent on the front end. So we're going to spend all our efforts optimizing the front end in this presentation. The backend stuff includes database queries, remote web service calls, assembling the HTML, or the so-called business logic. Whereas the front end part includes executing JavaScript, rendering the page. We're going to look at network time, DNS lookups, latency, downloading resources. Those are images, JavaScript, and CSS. And this presentation today is only about front-end performance. So where should we start? I know this sounds obvious, but let's start fixing the easy stuff. There's so much stuff we can improve to make our website faster. Let's start by fixing the easy stuff. Once we've done that, we can move on to the more difficult things. When we're talking about performance, there are two types of things we have to look at. The perceived performance, that is, how it feels to a human user, how the person looking at the website feels. Is it fast? Is it slow? And the technical performance. The technical performance is easy to measure, normally in milliseconds. The perceived performance is more difficult to measure because it's how the user feels the website. Does it feel fast? Does it feel slow? Does it feel sluggish? How does it feel? I would suggest today that we look at improving perceived performance first, because we build the website for end users. They have to feel that it feels fast. And once we fix the perceived performance, we can move on to the technical performance. So, chapter one, optimizing images. As all of you know in here, there are basically three types of images we use on the web today. There's PNG, there's JPEG, and there's still GIF. Okay, GIF is almost dead, apart from animations on Facebook and Google+. But we use PNG for images which contain solid color. For example, logos, charts, or diagrams. And we use JPEG for stuff that includes gradients, like photos, for example. And as I said, with GIF, let's try and avoid GIF completely unless we have a GIF animation that we're posting onto a social media network site. Now, when we're talking about image optimization, there are two types. This is a little bit tricky. There's lossless image optimization and lossy image optimization. I'm going to read this out aloud. Lossless image optimization reduces file size by eliminating data from an image which leads a human to perceive the image as looking identical to the original. So, in other words, we have our unoptimized image, we take out data from this image, and the resulting image still looks identical to the original image. And this is quite possible with PNG. And the opposite is lossy. That's where we take the original image, apply some type of optimization algorithm, and the resulting image has a smaller file size, but it looks slightly different if you look at it very carefully or if you zoom in. Now, the majority of us here are developers and DevOps people, but we have to understand that designers prefer lossless over lossy. They do not want their images being post-processed, really. They want their images from their Photoshop or their photo application software to look perfect on the website. PNG is a fantastic lossless file format. There's a lot of data in PNG that you can simply take out that you can't even see. And that's what we're going to do to our PNG files. In addition, we can increase the level of compression in the PNG file without changing the resultant image. Now, I've linked here to three really good tools which do all this work for you. You don't have to understand the technical details of PNG to optimize them. Use tools to do it. And please click on the links in the slide, download these tools. They run on Linux and macOS. and play with them. I want you to understand that every single time a designer gives you an image, you can always make it smaller out of experience. So never take an image from a designer and put it straight on your website. You always have to optimize it first. I've been working in this field for almost 20 years, and I've never met a designer who understands image optimization. And because image optimization is a pretty boring and repetitive task, don't do it manually. That's a waste of your time. Build image optimization into your development process. The ideal position for it is between your development and your staging server. Automate image optimization. Do not waste your valuable time doing it manually. JPEG, on the other hand, when you compress a JPEG file, it never looks as good as the original. There's a lot of data in JPEG you can take out, like, for example, thumbnails stored inside the image. But at the end of the day, you have a compression lever. And this lever goes between 0 and 100. The lower the compression, the better the image looks. The higher the compression, the worse the image looks. So it's always a trade-off. You always trade off file size for quality. And of course, designers want quality. We want small file size. So at the end of the day, we have to talk to our designers, and we have to make compromises. We have to figure out a level of compression that the designer and the DevOps or the developers guys can live with. Now, JPEG has one really cool feature which PNG doesn't have. It's called progressive JPEG. Progressive JPEG is simply where a low-resolution version of the image is downloaded first, and then in progressive parses, more and more data is downloaded. So as you can see on my example here, in this case, it's a progressive JPEG with three passes. The first pass is not much data, the second pass is a bit more, and the third pass, finally, the whole image is downloaded. Now, the advantage of this approach is, and we're coming back to perceived performance here, the end user has something to look at whilst he or she is waiting for the rest of the image to download. And that's important. You have to give something to the end user, you have to occupy the end user as early as possible. Otherwise, he or she gets bored and his satisfaction level goes down. As an example, I've taken two typical banner images off our company website. The first one is stored as a PNG file, which in this case is the wrong file format for the image. It's 113 kilobytes. And we have the identical file exported from the TIFF to a JPEG, and it's only 48K. In other words, it's 57% smaller. And even if you look at these two images very, very closely, which you can do after you download the slides, you will see they are almost identical. Only when you start zooming into the images and looking at the edges can you see compression artifacts. But just looking at it on your screen, they're identical. So I would suggest when you get an image from your designer and you don't know whether a PNG or a JPEG file format would be better, simply save them in both and have a look at them. Which one looks better? What are the file sizes? And after a while, you'll get a good feeling for which type of image is suitable for which type of image file format. So once we've optimized our images, there's still a lot more we can do. We've only just started. This chapter, or this section of the presentation, is going to look at reducing HTTP requests. Then I'm going to show you some tricks by combining HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. And once it's combined, we can minimize it. And finally, to squeeze the last bytes out of it, we can compress it. So every single asset that is linked into an HTML page has to be downloaded. And every single time an asset is downloaded, it has to create an HTTP request. Now, these three websites here, when I wrote these slides on the 16th of August, I counted how many requests they generate. Microsoft.com generated 79 HTTP requests. So that means the HTML document was sent to the browser, then the HTML document referenced 79 different objects. And every single one of these objects, these assets, had to be downloaded. Apple.com generated 50 requests, and Google.com only 9. Now, We all know in this room which of these three websites is fastest. It's Google, right? They've spent a long time optimizing every single byte, and they only generate 9 requests. Apple.com generates, as I said, 50 requests. Our goal, if we're interested in performance, is to reduce the number of HTTP requests to an absolute minimum. Because HTTP requests are really slow. And if you develop mobile apps, you'll see they're even slower because 3G and 4G networks have even more latency than the internet. So by decreasing the number of HTTP requests, we can increase the page load time. Our goal is to get the number of requests to a minimum. And this has a huge impact on performance. So how do we do that, okay? How do we do that? It's much easier than you think. When we're junior developers, we learn to put our code into modules. Then we load these modules into our web page. And very, very often this leads to us, for example, in this case, loading multiple CSS files. In this case, 4 CSS files. Now, instead of loading 4 separate files, why not put all the content of the 4 files into one file and then just download one file, hence saving 3 requests? That's a huge benefit. How do we do that? Well, there are many ways to combine files. I like using Linux, and I would use cats for that job. And of course, CSS file combination is a really boring job. Our time is too valuable to do it manually. So add CSS combination to your build process. Again, the ideal place for this is between production and between development and staging. Now, once we put our CSS files into one file, there's still more we can do, because we're interested in not only reducing the number of HTTP requests, but also reducing the file size of the resultant file. Now, in the case of this CSS file, which is the first 12 lines, I believe, from bootstrap.css, there's a lot of junk that we can take out, like all the comments. The comments are just for us developers. Machines don't care about comments. We can take out almost all the spaces. We can take out all the line returns. So instead of having a nicely formatted file like this, we can condense this into this. And again, we've saved, in this case, about 30% of the file size. Now, doing this type of work by hand, in particular minification, is a really mind-numbing job. So don't do it. Use tools to do it. There are really good tools. Yahoo UI Compressor, something I personally have used for at least 10 years. It works extremely well. You give it an unoptimized file, it's a little Java program, it runs over it, and it produces a highly minimized file. Some of the newer tools, like Google Minify, are also extremely good, and in some cases will make smaller file sizes than the Yahoo tool. And again, as I said, add minification to your build process. Do not do it manually. And I would suggest you try multiple tools to find out which one works best for your application. Now, what you can do to CSS, you can do to JavaScript, too. It's exactly the same, just the tools are different. So combine your JavaScript files. Add JavaScript combination to your build process. And in addition to removing all the comments, line returns, and spaces, with JavaScript, you can also do token replacement, which means you can rename the internal properties and variables to very, very short ones. Like here, for example, that's the unoptimized form, and that's the same thing optimized. Considerably smaller, right? And again, add JavaScript minification to your build process. I've linked to tools here which do a really, really good job. And test multiple tools to find out which one works best. Once you've combined your JavaScript and CSS files, once you've minified your JavaScript and CSS files, you're not done. You can even squeeze more bytes out of these files by compressing them. And Apache offers this really great module called moddeflate, which does this work for you. You simply need to tell Apache to compress all files with the MIME type text CSS and or application JavaScript, and it will compress the files on the fly and deliver them to the end user in compressed form. And by doing that, we can save an additional 50 to 70% of the file size. So what started out life as, say, 100 kilobytes of JavaScript and CSS, we can get down to often about 15. And I've linked to some tools at the bottom of the page that will help you figure out how to do compression using Apache. Now, where we put our JavaScript and CSS in an HTML page is also really important. Quite simply, browsers do not render a page before loading the JavaScript. Okay? And before loading the CSS, I'm sorry. And JavaScript prevents browsers from rendering the page. And the reason being that JavaScript might change the document using something like document write. So the secret here is to put the CSS at the top of the file and put the JavaScript at the bottom. Now, I'm quite aware that most websites don't do this, but try it out for yourself. You will see that the page load time is lower when the JavaScript is at the bottom of the page. A sample HTML5 document should look something like this. The CSS is at the top here, minified, of course. We're linking our JavaScript, and then we can have the inline JavaScript at the bottom. Try it out for yourself. You'll be surprised. Now, part three of the presentation. Use a content delivery network. I think most of you are aware of what a content delivery network is. It's basically a distributed collection of servers. And there are many, like 10 or 15 years ago, content delivery networks were something for really, really big corporations because they were very expensive to set up. Nowadays, that is no longer the case. The advantage of using a content delivery network is that you can separate your application server, that is, the server which produces the HTML, from your asset server. This reduces server load on the asset server, and of course, it distributes your bandwidth to the nodes of the content delivery network. But the main bonus for using a content delivery network is to reduce the distance between the end user and the server. And this reduces latency. Lower latency equals faster speed. It also has some satellite benefits. For example, you remove the so-called single point of failure. So that means if one node in the CDN goes down, your website still works because the image data can then be delivered from another node. And it offers a bit of additional security. For example, a denial of service attack is more difficult, and it offers resistance against spikes in traffic, like you get on the front page of Slashdot. I would say to you today to serve all large assets, and those are videos, flash files, images, but also CSS and JavaScript from a CDN. Without advertising the first one, I personally use the first company here, which works extremely well and is relatively cheap. Number four is a little bit more technical. It's called domain sharding, or serving assets from multiple domain names or host names. Typically, web browsers, depending on the web browser, I must say, download between 2 and 6 resources in parallel. So, say for example, we have an HTML page with 10 resources referenced in the HTML. The first 6 or so will be downloaded first, and then the remaining 4 will be downloaded afterwards. If we can somehow trick the browser into downloading more stuff in parallel, we'll get the data, the image data, from the backend server or from the CDN to the user quicker, and therefore lower the page load time. Now, the way we can do this is to simply set up some subdomains. Say, for example, our domain name is example.com. We could serve our images from, for example, i1.example.com or i2.example.com. Or we could serve our JavaScript or our CSS from 2 subdomains. And I would highly recommend that you make sure your subdomains are also on a CDN. this trick, domain sharding, has a huge impact on performance. It can really, really speed up your web application. However, on the other side, you have to remember that with every single host name, you have a DNS lookup. So that means your browser has to ask a DNS server, what is the IP address of this domain name? And this can take a few hundred milliseconds too. So your job as web developers is to figure out the best number of subdomains for your project. Now, I can't tell you to use one or two or three because it really depends on your project. I know for the websites that we produce in our company, around two subdomain names for images and one for JavaScript and CSS work really well. But you have to figure out for yourself what the best number is for you. And of course, as we're talking about DNS, DNS services are not created equal either. Typically, when you buy a domain name, your registrar or your ISP will give you access to a DNS server free of charge. Right? This is normally free of charge, and it works. The DNS service, it converts the domain name into an IP address. However, this is not necessarily the fastest way of doing it. In the meantime, there are so-called geo-aware or distributed DNS systems. Rackspace, or again, Amazon Web Services, offer exactly what you want. And if you're really interested in getting the last bit of performance out of your website, I really recommend going for a distributed system over a single server solution. Now, the final part in this presentation is the most technical, but also a very, very important one. Typically, on a web application, you'll have parts of the application which change often, and you'll have a lot of stuff that always stays exactly the same. For example, the company logo. It changes occasionally, but generally stays the same. For example, product photos. Once a product has been released, that particular product or that product number or product code stays the same. Or even event photos. Often on company blogs, companies will publish photos of their last corporate event. These types of images are predestined to be cached for a long time. If we can figure out a way that when a user comes to a website twice, the second time he doesn't have to download the data, we're going to make that web page appear really quickly. Because getting data from the user's cache is always going to be faster than getting data from across the internet, regardless of whether we optimize the image and use a CDN. So as web developers, we have to figure out which parts of our web application or our website are cacheable and which parts are not. And once we've done that, to force the browser to cache images or cache CSS or cache JavaScript for a long time, we simply have to set the expires header. We can set the expires header to 1 year in advance. And this tells the browser to only download this image after 1 year and 1 second. So if the user comes to the web page in the next year, it will load the image from the user's cache. And as I said, this is always going to be faster than downloading it across the internet. So serving data from a cache has a huge positive impact on performance. But of course, how do we know what's going to stay the same forever? Sometimes non-changeable stuff does indeed change. Like, for example, the marketing department decides they want a slightly changed logo. They want to change a color of the logo, or they want to make it a little bit bigger. So as web developers, we have to have a process for this possibility. Non-changing resources sometimes change. So how do we deal with that? Basically, we make sure that our file names have some type of version ID in them. And there's really two ways of doing this. I prefer this way, where we change the name of the file. So when we release a new version, for example, of this PNG file, of the logo, we would simply increment the timestamp here. Here we have 2013, 08, 29, and 01. We would simply increment the file name, And therefore, we would force the CDN to go back to the backend server and get a new version of the file. And we would also force the cache on the user's browser to download the latest image data. Now, as I said, there are two ways to implement this. There's this way, by putting a question mark after the file name, which works really well if you're serving the CSS file or PNG file from Apache. However, with many CDNs, it does not work, because not many CDNs do not look at everything that comes after the question mark. So that's why I would recommend always actually changing the file name to force the CDN to get new data from the back end. So those are my five suggestions for improving your performance or the performance of your web applications. But where should you start? You've got to start somewhere. You know, if you can't be bothered to implement all five approaches, where should you start? What is the lowest hanging fruit? So if you're a lazy developer, where should you start? My recommendation would be, because it's pretty easy to implement, use a CDN. Get the distance between the server and the end user as low as possible. Reduce your latency. And you'll see by simply using a CDN, your page will appear, the perceived performance will increase. It will feel faster, and it will feel much faster. And adding a CDN nowadays is a very, very small additional cost. So if you're not really lazy, but just lazy, what should you do? Okay, use a CDN. And secondly, look at your images. Really, look at your images. Most websites have hundreds or thousands or hundreds of thousands of images. I guarantee you can save a lot of data transfer by looking at these images. Figure out, am I using the right file format? Have I optimized my images? Have I set my JPEGs too progressive? Have I removed all the rubbish or the garbage out of PNG files? Have I removed the thumbnails from JPEGs? Optimize your images. Okay, but you're not really lazy, and you're not lazy. You're the type of developer who jumps out of bed in the morning, he's happy to go to work, or she's happy to go to work. And what should you implement? All the approaches, of course. So if you're really interested in web performance, and it's something I've been interested in for many years, and in my opinion, you should be interested in this topic, because I think it's something that's really important, because your job as a web developer is to increase the user satisfaction of your web application. That's your responsibility. I highly recommend these three books, and not just one of them, but all three. Read them all, study them. They are packed full of information on how to improve the performance of your website. Now, I'd like you to look at these slides in your web browser. And this is the domain name, the tiny link. Go to this web address, please. Look at the slides in your own time and click on the links. So at the end of the day, the satisfaction that the user has is in your hands. And if you can increase the user satisfaction of your website, you can be sure your boss is going to notice this, and you're going to get paid more money. Believe me. Thank you. Cyril. Now, if you'd like to ask some questions, my colleague Cyril will come up to the front, and you can ask in Mandarin or in English, and he'll translate for me. So do we have any questions, first of all? Or any suggestions? Or what do you think about performance? Like, do you care about performance? If so, why or why not? Please.
Hello. 怎么样让 developer 跟 designer 之间合作，然后整个工作流程是怎么做？这样在 performance 方面。Here，you
tell me the question.
Okay, John, can you share about how you lead your team, and when you lead a team, how do you communicate with them and lead your team to a better performance in when you develop the website.
In our particular case, we have a highly distributed team. We have 50% in Bremen, Germany, and 50% here in Taipei. And this guy, he works in our department, and we have some more people working in Taipei. So we have the additional problem that we work in completely different time zones. Germany is -6 hours or -7 hours in winter. And we use video conferencing. Every single day, this poor guy has to see my face on Google Hangouts or Skype, depending which one works better. And a lot of the time, I talk to the team members, in particular about performance and about security, like the first session today, trying to help them to understand why it's important. Instead of preaching to them and telling them why they have to work in a way they do, I try to help them understand themselves why they should be interested in performance and in security. That's my other favorite topic. Do we have any more questions? Don't be frightened.
Do you have any skill on how to improve your performance, like some tools or some...
I especially wrote these slides in HTML so I could link to external tools. And if you click on this website or type it into your computer, you'll see each slide has got tools on it which do a certain job. Like there are lots of tools to do image optimization, which are completely automated. There's lots of tools to do JavaScript minification and JavaScript compression. And all these tools are freely available. You simply, as a web developer, have to take them and add them to your process, to your build process normally. I mean, usually, at least in Germany, we typically work with three sets of servers. We have our development servers, where the developers work on. We have one server, which is called the staging server, and that's kind of a finished version of the application. This version of the application then goes to the quality assurance team, and these team members then try to destroy the application. And if they can't destroy it, we then push from the staging server to the production server. Okay? Do you work with three servers too, or just two?
Just two.
Just two, okay. We used to work that way, but with a certain number of team members, it makes sense to have a third server to try and destroy the application and a separate team whose job it is to destroy the application, try and break it.
Okay, thank you.
My pleasure.
Excuse me, sir. I have one question. Do you have... used any NoSQL database to speed up your application for a lot of reading requests?
At the moment, the applications upon which I work, I've always been able to fulfill the performance requirements using MySQL, MySQL, and several layers of caching. I've never had an application at the moment which could not be fulfilled using MySQL. So we just stick with MySQL for the time being. But I'm quite aware of NoSQL, and I know there are many people who love NoSQL from its performance perspective.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, excuse me. I have a question. In your slide, page number 9, you told me concentrate on the lower time to first byte, TTFB, but in my opinion, this is the big point time to show about your HTML. But today your topic is talking about the front end, so I don't know what's mine. Number 9, thank you.
This one.
Yeah, TTFB.
You're right. This talk was actually about front end performance. However, I think it's important to mention one of the reasons we should be interested in performance is because Google considers web pages which are fast to be better than those that are slow. Therefore, I found it would have been incomplete to not include this piece of information about Google. Now, Google announced in 2010 that they said faster websites increase user satisfaction and improve the overall quality of the web. But it was only recent research, to which I've linked to here, behind this link, which found out exactly what that meant. Because for quite a few years, nobody really knew exactly which metric is Google looking at. Are they looking at the time it takes a page to render? Are they looking at the onload time? Or which technical metric are they actually looking at? And it turns out it's this time to first byte metric. And that's why I included it in the presentation.
Okay. I have another question. So do you have any suggestion about how to speed up your maybe back-end performance?
Yes, but that would be a whole session.
Okay, thank you.
My pleasure.
Okay, thanks for Jonathan's sharing. 那我们这一场的演讲大概是到这里结束。我们下一场呢，大概是在五分钟之后开始，请大家尽快就坐，谢谢。
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, thank you very much.